our most righteous King. Will we honor him this morning and stand up on our feet and give our God a great praise? Come on and honor God today and say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, he's worthy. Hallelujah, God. It's in the scriptures of the word of God in the book of Matthew, chapter 21, starting at verse number 6. We are reminded in the scriptures when it says, and the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they sat him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We are reminded on today that this is Palm Sunday. This is the Sunday that Jesus came and greeted the multitude and fulfilled the prophecy that Hosanna, which means Savior, the Redeemer, the one that came to bring salvation unto his people. He came and granted them to fulfill the prophecy to say, I am here. I am the one. I am the one that came to set the captives free. Y'all looking at me like I'm saying something strange. Y'all looking at me like y'all don't understand. So God, I thank you with the understanding that I have of my own salvation. God, I thank you for keeping me and keeping us, oh God, and I write my thank you for saving me when you didn't have to. Thank you for paying the ransom for the sins that I committed, God, in the name of Jesus, just because you loved us. Now, God, we are careful to always give you the glory and the honor that you are due. I rebuke the Satan and all of his devourer, God, that in his spirit that is not like you, God. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus and cast it right back down to the pits of hell from which it came. God, we loose in this atmosphere your love and the liberty of praise. And Lord God, we are careful to always worship you and give you the glory. Now, God, make this atmosphere conducive for your spirit to rest, rule, and abide amongst your people. We call on deliverance. We call on your Holy Spirit. And we call on this atmosphere to be an atmosphere of praise. And it's in Jesus' name. It's in Jesus' name. Now lift up your hands and just give us a wave offering and say, thank you, Jesus. God, we love you. God, we magnify you. God, you are wonderful. God, you are magnificent. God, you are excellent. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Let's just pray the Lord. Let's just pray the Lord. Let's just pray.
nothing better to do. Come on. Hallelujah. What's better than giving God praise? Because when you praise Him, your blessings come down. Come on. Come on here, come on here. Thank you. him this morning? Is it for him this morning? Is it for him this morning? Oh, come on, somebody praise God in the house.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah. Don't just give him some praise. Give him all of your praise. Come on. Yeah, oh, come on. Come on and praise him. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, it's all for you. It's all for you. God, it's all for you. God, it's all for you. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries hallelujah. My hands will lift up in the air. My voice will cry out. I begin to dance. I begin to praise. I begin to worship. I begin to thank him. I begin to thank him. I think of his goodness and I lift my hands and it's all. God, it's all for you. God, it's all for you. Can I get any real witnesses out there that it's all? God, it's all for you. God, it's all for you. The reason why it's for you is because I'm chasing after you. No matter what I have to do. Because I need you more and more. I'm chasing after you. No matter what I have to do. Because I need you more and more. Help me say,
I'm chasing after you.
Come on.
No matter what I have to do,
I need
you
more,
more and more.
God, I'm chasing
after you.
Through my praise,
no matter what I have to do,
I need
you
more,
more and more.
More and more.
To you.
Keep on chasing.
I'm chasing.
praise my way.
I'm praising my
way. Gonna keep on praising.
I'm praising
my way. My way. Praising my way. Praising my way.
I'm praising my way.
I'm praising my way.
I'm praising
my way. I'm trying to be, come on.
Closer.
I want to be closer.
Closer.
Oh, keep on chasing. More and more.
More and more.
God, I need you.
More and more.
I need you.
More and more.
God, I need you.
More and more.
God, I need you more and more. I need you more,
more and more.
I need you more and more,
more and more.
God, I need you more,
more and more.
Mm-hmm.
I just need everybody, if you would. Never mind. More and more, I'm chasing after you. I just wonder if there's any desperate people of God in the house this morning that's chasing after him, and you know you need more and more of him. Where are the desperate people at who are not ashamed, who are not afraid to lift your voice in praise and adoration to him? Where are those who really need him more and more? Thankful. I'm triumphant and grateful. Today, right now, I am triumphant and grateful. In spite of what it looks like, in spite of what it feels like, I am triumphant and grateful. Any first-time visitors here with us this morning, if you would, just wave your hand. God bless you, my sisters. God bless you. So good to see you. Come on, put your hands together for our visitors. Hallelujah. Anybody else? Any other visitors? Don't want to miss nobody. Amen. Amen. Come on, put your hands together for our brothers and sisters in the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So glad to see you. So glad to see you. We welcome you here to the Potter's House Dayton International Ministries, where our spiritual father, our Pura, is none other than the Bishop Mark C. McGuire. Hallelujah. Come on. Now let's stand and give thanks to God for our angel of this house. Come on. Put your hands together. Open up your mouth and thank God for the angel of this house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, God. Oh, God. I come against that spirit of slothfulness. I come against the spirit of tiredness. I come against that spirit of as usual. As usual. Some of y'all sitting here like you owe, like God owe you something, and you ain't put your hands together. You ain't clapped. You ain't said nothing. You looking around. I don't understand. You are in here breathing, and you looking like you ain't thankful. I'm triumphant and grateful. Today, God, I'm grateful that you gave me yet another chance to get it right. I'm grateful, God. Woo! I pray that you don't leave here the same way your face is looking. I pray you don't leave here the same way your spirit is feeling right now. I pray the spirit of the Lord heavy upon your life right now. I pray that whatever it is, that God will give it to you quickly and you will open your mouth and give God praise. Hallelujah. At the end of service, we take our offering. We ask that no one will please leave before the benediction. Amen. Oh God. You will see some of the sons and daughters coming to lay something on the altar. They're simply sowing a seed into the word of God that has just been spoken over their lives. And if that's you, I pray that whatever it is, that you just come quickly, lay it on the altar. Then go back by faith, knowing that what you sown, you shall reap in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you right now. Father, we honor you right now. You are grateful to us. God, we thank you right now. You've been great to us. You've been awesome to us. You've been our master. You've been our savior. You've been our healer. You've been our deliverer. You've been our provider. God, you've been our peace. You kept our minds. You've been our joy. You've been everything we needed. God, and we thank you right now. Forgive us, oh God, for not praising you like we should have. Forgive us, oh God, for not moving and doing what you told us to do. Forgive us, oh God. Forgive us, oh God. And God, we receive your forgiveness. We say we are free indeed. Let the liberty of your anointing fall in this place today. Free in the name of Jesus. Even it out, oh God. Even it out, oh God, in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you for the angel of this house. God, we thank you for the word that's going to come forth in the name of Jesus. God, we speak blessings to our bishop right now. No lack. Touch his mind even right now, oh God. Put his spirit at ease and at rest in you, oh God. We charge the angels even right now. Your glory fill this temple. Your glory fills this temple. And God, we love you. We love you, God. We trust you. We believe in you. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Every heart said amen. Amen. Come on, put your hands together. Bless God. Stand to your feet and declare that you've been changed. You've been healed. Come on, let the devil know that you've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Come on, let your hands be the palms for this Sunday. Now put them up and just begin to wave to your Savior. Come on, give him a wave offering. God, thank God for snatching you out of the hands of the enemy. When the sin that you've done should have sent you straight to hell, he snatched you. That's why we lift our hands to him. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for healing us. Thank you for cleansing us. Thank you for washing us. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Hey God, come on, lift your hands to him. Open up your mouth and just say thank you. Hey, oh, oh.
I have been touched, changed, healed, totally free from sin, every shackle. broke, now I can live again.
Help me say it.
I have been touched, changed, healed, totally free from sin. Every shackle broke, now I can live again.
Say it again. Every shackle.
Every shackle.
Broke.
Broke.
Now I can live.
Now I can live.
I've been restored.
I've been restored. I've been renewed.
I've come alive.
I've come alive.
Because of you.
Because of you.
I've been restored.
I've been restored.
I've been renewed.
I've been renewed.
I've come alive.
I've come alive.
Because of you.
Because of you.
I have been set free.
I have been set free.
By your love.
By your love.
Every mistake.
Every mistake.
Covered up.
Covered up.
All right.
Every shackle. Every shackle.
Yes, now.
Now I can live.
Yes. I've been restored.
I've been restored.
Renewed.
I've been renewed.
I've come alive.
I've come alive.
Because of you.
Because of you.
I've been restored.
I've been restored.
Been renewed.
I've been renewed.
I've come alive.
I've come alive.
Because of you.
Because of you.
Yes. I have been set free.
I have been set free.
Oh, come on, come on. By your love.
By your love.
Every mistake.
Every mistake.
Cover it up.
Cover it up.
Again, I've been touched.
Yeah, I have been touched, changed, healed, totally free from sin. Every shackle broke. Now I can live again.
Say it again. I have.
I have been touched, changed, healed. Totally free from sin. Every shackle.
Y'all better say it.
Broke.
Yeah.
Now I can live.
Hey. Oh, come on, say it with us. I have been touched. Come on.
I have been touched.
Come on.
chains, healed, totally free.
He said, you're not lying, you're prophesying. Come on.
Sing.
Yeah.
Every shackle goes
broke.
Broke.
Now I can.
Now I can live.
I've been restored.
I've been restored. I've been renewed.
I've come alive.
I've come alive.
Because
of you.
I've been restored.
I've been restored.
I've been renewed.
I've been renewed.
I've come alive.
I've come alive.
Because
of you.
Anybody in here free?
By your love.
Every mistake.
Every mistake.
I want it covered up.
Covered up.
I have been set free.
I have been set free.
By your love.
By your love.
Every mistake. You covered up.
Covered up.
With all my sins.
With all of my sins.
Between us.
Between us. In the job. Unexplainable. Unconditional love.
Aren't you glad about that today? It was your love. In your love, there is freedom and no more condemnation. Everybody sing, in your love.
In your love, there is freedom.
Aren't y'all glad about that today? And no more condemnation.
And no more condemnation.
Stay right there. Say it again. In your love. Oh, oh, oh.
In your love there is freedom.
Oh, somebody worship him because you're free. And no more, no more.
And no more condemnation.
Condemnation.
Oh,
say that. God, in your love.
In
you're free in this house. Come on, we're free to worship. I'm free to worship. In your love, there is freedom. I'm free to worship. Come on. And no more condemnation. Come on, in your love.
In your love, there is freedom.
And no more. They can't hold that sin over you no more. Come on. In your love, God.
In your love, there is freedom.
Bishop said, I did it. I survived.
And no more
God is good. And I'm moving on. Come on. So I'm free. I'm free. I'm free. Yeah. Shame, come on.
And no more condemnation.
Say it one more time, God. In your love, hallelujah.
In your love, there is freedom.
I believe y'all. And no more, no more.
And no more condemnation.
Worship him, come on. I've been renewed. I've come alive because of you. God, I'm restored. I've been renewed. I've come alive because of you. Yes, I did it. I'm free. God is good. I can move on. Come on. I'm restored. I'm renewed. I've come alive because of you. I'm the real me. I'm the real me. Because I'm free. No condemnation. Oh, I'm restored. I'm renewed. I've come alive.
I've been restored.
Come alive.
I've come alive.
Because of you.
Because of you.
I've been restored.
I've been renewed.
I've come alive.
Oh,
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. I love Jesus. What about you out there? Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, it's because he first loved me. Everybody say that today. Oh,
oh, oh, how I love Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
Jesus.
Do you love him today? Everybody say it. Oh,
oh,
oh, yes, yes, yes,
yes.
Oh, come on and say it.
Jesus.
If you don't love him, say it. Sing it all.
Oh.
I love
Jesus.
Do you love him today? Jesus. Come on, come on, y'all. Because, come on, come on. There is a name that I love to hear. I love to sing. I love to sing his word. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Oh, sounds like music. The name of Jesus, it's in my ear. Oh, yeah, it's the sweetest name, sweetest name, sweetest name on earth. How many of y'all living for real? Come on. Everybody sing, oh.
Oh,
how I love him.
How,
yes.
I
love him.
Love,
I love him.
Jesus.
I love him. I love him. I love him.
Jesus.
Oh, everybody sing, oh.
How
I love Jesus. I love Jesus. Yes, I do. Why? I've been renewed. I've come alive because of you. Help me say it.
I've been restored. I've been renewed.
Because he loves me. I've come alive.
I've come alive
because of you.
Because of you.
I've been restored.
I've been restored.
Yeah, I've been renewed.
I've
what
been
about
renewed.
You out there? Anybody out there alive?
I've come alive
because because of his love, because of you. Say it again, I've been restored.
I've been restored.
I've been renewed.
I've been renewed.
God, I've come alive. Time, come on here. In your love.
In your love, there is freedom.
Yes, yeah. And no more condemnation.
And no more condemnation.
Yes, say it again. God, in your love, in your love.
In your love, there is
oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. There's no more.
And no more condemnation.
In your love. Come on here.
In your love. Breath is freedom.
And no more, no more.
And no more.
Been renewed. I've come alive because of you. Come on.
I've been restored. I've been renewed. I've come alive because of you. I've been restored. I've been renewed. I've come alive because of you. I've been renewed. I've come alive because of you. I've been restored.
I've been renewed. I've come alive. Because of you.
Because of you.
I've been restored. Been renewed.
I've been renewed.
I'm alive.
I've come alive.
Because of you.
Because of you.
I'm been restored.
Been renewed.
Come alive.
Awesome Savior, we glorify His name. One more time, softly. I've been restored. I've been renewed. Tell somebody, I'm still alive. I'm still alive. I'm still alive. Because of you, I am still alive. Well, good morning on this Palm Sunday. We welcome you here. We're glad to see you. Amen. Look at the person on your right and left telling me you look good too, and you look good too, and you look good. You look good sitting right there. Yeah, you look good sitting right there. Amen. Glad to see you. We appreciate you. God is an awesome God. Amen. So we are thankful. We appreciate it. Before I do anything, can we just give a great round of applause for the happy birthday for Mr. Mark Baxter? Can we just... Big Tony. It's his birthday yesterday. I called and wished him happy birthday on the wrong day. Amen. So it was late yesterday. So happy birthday. Amen. We appreciate each and every one of you. Don't forget the morning prayer, 6 a.m. Amen. And someone from Potter's House, designated, will be praying in the morning. So you want to be on that prayer line at 6. It has been such a tremendous blessing. Don't forget to order your My Color is Love t-shirts for Resurrection Sunday, which is next Sunday. Amen. And so we're excited. Looking forward to a great production. Amen. And so we are excited about that. Amen. Don't forget to join me if you are 16 to 35 years of age and you are free at 6:30 p.m. on Tuesday. Don't forget to join me at the Theology Cafe. Amen. We'll be upstairs in the McLaughlin Hall, hopefully for not too long, but it is quaint enough to do that at this point, so we appreciate it. All those over 35 that want to sneak in, be nosy, and learn a little something, you can do that. Amen. We are welcoming you as well. We had great dialogue, great study on last week, and we're looking forward to that continuing. Amen. So we're thankful. I want to highlight a business today. Miss Deborah Moody, you raise your hand. Graceful Hands, amen. And so if you are in need of a massage with Grace, you can do that. If you remind her that you were in service on the 9th of April and you are the first person to make a half hour appointment with her. I will take care of it for you. Amen. So see her after service somewhere and make sure that she gets your info and whoever's first. Now, don't be nice and have nine first. It's one first. Now, one first. And so we want to make sure that that happens. Our marriage ministry pushing forward. Amen. With Elder Moss. Amen. We are thankful. So we our first one will be in April. Right, this Wednesday. All right, every second and fourth Wednesday, starting with this Wednesday at 5:30 p.m. So you can come here, get some great empowerment and training about marriage, and then flow right into worship service. Amen. So that'll be a great time, and you can see Elder Moss for any more information concerning that. We look forward to a great time with him and that. Amen. Coming up later in the month, April the 26th through the 28th, we have our Transformation Conference, and we are excited about that and bringing in the Florida cartel. Amen. I'll be an all Florida lineup, and so we are thankful for that. And a couple of my brothers will be here Wednesday and Thursday, Pastor Brown, Pastor Bartley. And then, of course, on Friday night, her first time preaching here for us is Lady Narlene McLaughlin. And so we are excited about having the first lady of our church, mother church, and of the fellowship to be here with us. Powerful woman of God. She's the chief administrator for over $60 million worth of property. For the Kingdom Plaza, for the Potter's House Christian Academy, and of course the Potter's House International Ministry. She is what Bishop calls the neck that makes the head move. Amen. He says he could do all the preaching, but she has to handle all the ministry. So she is a powerful woman of God, and she is so excited about being here. I could hear it. I felt it. So we're just looking forward to it. She's my mom. Amen. And so we are thankful to have her here on the 28th. And then on the 30th, that Sunday morning, my spiritual father, Bishop McLaughlin, will be presenting us with whatever the Lord has given him for us in this hour. Amen. And I'm not telling you to don't invite people every other Sunday. Amen. But if you want to kick off us inviting people to church on a Sunday, that won't be a bad Sunday to invite some people. Amen. To kick off a Sunday and Sunday invitations. He is a powerful, powerful prophet. He is tremendous in his delivery. And he always has something to say that will change your life. I promise you, every time he opens his mouth, it changes your life. And so you would want to be here for that. We want to continue to lift up those that are struggling in their body. Amen. Home or in the hospital. We do know that Brother Watts had a pretty successful hip surgery. Amen. So he is recuperating. So so if you felt like when you drove up in the parking lot, your car wasn't getting bullied at all, then, that's because Brother Watts is chilling right now. So I told him he's the only person that scare a car. Amen. Make your car turn the other way. And so, but he's doing well. He's kept in contact with me. So we're very thankful for that. Amen. I want to put our hands together. I know she's taking care of something in the back right now. But for Sister Veronica, Sister Anita, and Pastor Alex from Kettering SDA Church, we had a tremendous health fair on yesterday. So we are tremendously thankful. Tremendously thankful. It was the bomb. And so we are thankful for that. And everybody that participated, media, sound, the double DJs, she's trying to steal your name. She's talking about she Pooter Puff or somebody. Pooter Puff, DJ Pooter Puff, and Sir Ron-a-Lot. I was going to say Sir Mix-a-Lot, but you know what he used to sing. So Sir Ron-a-Lot. And so we're thankful Elder put together some entertainment for us. So we just appreciate everybody. Food service, hospitality, pastoral care. Everybody was pumping and jumping on yesterday. So we are thankful for that. A lot of things happened on yesterday. I want to also welcome not only a good friend, but a son, Pastor Mike Miller in the house. Evangelist Mike Miller. And we're thankful been traveling all over the world and preaching, and we had great time catching up yesterday. And he'll be around. You bring a couple cards with you? Okay, he'll be around after service. If any of you are traveling and need some hotel stay, he has some free discount cards that'll bless you. Amen. They are absolutely free. All you have to do is register it and use it. Amen. And so if you're thinking about going and using a hotel in the next whatever, 2 months, 3 months, 2 years, you want to get one of these cards from him. So see him after service. And everybody, this is the part I like, everybody can have one and it don't cost me nothing. I want to bless all y'all with a $200 gift card in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. How about that? How many pastors doing that around the city? Just everybody. You don't have to be first in this one. Just come one, come all. Hallelujah. And so we are thankful for that. All right. Don't forget, we have a special love offering. If you want to leave something after service for Bishop Mack's birthday, we'll be flying down to just be with him. And so we want to just make sure that you do that and sow into that situation. And it's a good time. Also, do we have any first-time visitors that would like to go to a basketball game tonight? I've given them away. All right. Man, you ain't nowhere near first. I'm going to tell your mama. She's sitting right down here, Scott. So I got my Young Life upstairs. Hey, yo, Young Life. Yeah. Hey, yo, Young Life. Yeah. You going to take this journey with me? Oh, yeah. All right, so we are appreciative of them. If you have any teenagers tomorrow, we are having a special Young Life. We'll be outside. We'll be grilling and having a great time, party with a purpose. But also we'll be remembering some friends and loved ones who either through tragedy or violence or whatever have gone on. And so we just want to remember them, but just a special tribute, just a special time to just be intentional. Amen. And then we're going to pray for all those families that have had to deal with that. And it's going to be our teams leading prayer, teams praying in segments. It's just going to be a powerful move, I believe, of God. And we're thankful. And the sheriff is sponsoring the night. Amen. And so we are thankful for that. And I'm appreciative of my relationship. I know we've got some misnomers and some stuff that we don't like when it comes to law enforcement and all that. But I'm very thankful for my relationship with Chief Beal, Lieutenant Kim Hill, the sheriff, Judge Newman, Judge Rice. I'm very thankful for the marshals who had their dogs out here yesterday. I'm very thankful for those guys. Amen. And so if there's ever been trouble, they've always been there for us in any kind of way. And all I have to do is call them and tell them I got a friend or I've got somebody that needs help. And Judge Rice, who is probably the chiefest of federal judges in the Southern District of Ohio, he responds as if he worked for me. And we are absolutely good friends, and probably feel bad because he the one sent me to jail. He probably thinking like, dang, the bishop. Well, I wasn't the bishop then. Lord have mercy. Barely the bishop now, but I sure wasn't the bishop then. So we want to remind you of that. Don't forget Givelify 71441 and TPHDIM. So at 4 p.m. today, the Dayton Airstrikers will be playing at their new home court, Sinclair Community College. And so we want to support that. Tickets that are $10 today are only $2. $2. So if you want the last few of the tickets here, who's only been here maybe less than five times and you want to go to the game? Your son's still lying. Somebody bring him to the altar. All right. So I got some. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4 hands went up there. Okay. 5, 6 hands. Okay. So I got. I need 8 tickets. All right. So you can't sell the 8 tickets. You got how many? So y'all know how many she has. So what we might have to do is we get the 8, put them down here. Y'all scrap. Just go for it. Just go for it. So we'll see what happens. Amen. Old school stuff. Amen. Can't fight, can't go. All right. All right, so we, I believe that's all the announcements. I'm getting too silly. Doc Bev is looking at me like it's time for the word. Amen. So I believe that's it. If I forgot something, I'll say it later. Hug 2 or 3 people and tell them that they are already triumphant, that victory is already in the air in Jesus' name.
noise in here? Any triumphant people in the house tonight? Come on, make some noise in here. Battle's already won.
The battle's already won.
There's a greater power.
There's a greater power in
me. Now come on, clap your hands like this.
I will not be defeated, for I know that there's victory for me. I've already won because of the blood Jesus shed on Calvary. Yes,
I am.
If I say it, till I can see it, claim it, it's already mine. The power of life and death is in the tongue. I speak life, triumphant.
Triumph.
I'm not defeated, no.
I am not defeated, triumph.
The battle's already won.
The battle's already won.
Come on, clap them hands, there's a greater power in me. Come on.
There's a greater power in me.
Say triumphant.
I am not defeated, triumph.
The battle's already won.
The battle's already won.
There's a greater power in me.
There's a greater power in me.
For whatever I lose, come on.
For whatever I lose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. If I find it, it's already bound.
I've got victory.
I've got victory stored up.
I'm more than a conqueror.
I'm more than a
thank you. Forsaken. Hallelujah. Somebody say Dayton is not forsaken. Matthew chapter 21, verse 9 in the King James says, "And the multitudes went before and that followed, cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." I'll read that same one in the Amplified. It says, "And the crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed him kept shouting, Hosanna, oh, be propitious, favorable, providential, promising, graciously inclined to the Son of David, the Messiah, blessed, praised, glorified is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. Oh, be favorably disposed in the highest heaven." Somebody shout hallelujah. We serve an awesome God who is worthy, amen, to be praised. So, Father, we thank you. We glorify you. We magnify you, for truly you are worthy. Now, God, help us to see what they saw when the glory came in. Help us to recognize the power that they felt when you rode in. You made that entry of triumph. You had allowed yourself to be damaged goods for us, that we would continue to be the prized possession of God. We glorify your name. Soon, even in the earth, we will celebrate your resurrection, your raising up, your taking all power in heaven and earth, and being back in that place of continual dominion, even in the earth, for dying for our sins. But before you rose, you had to die. And before you died, you had to be willing. So God, we thank you for a willing heart to take on the sins of the world, all of our mistakes, all of our sins that should have judged us and condemned us. You didn't just put them on you. You became them that you might make us your righteousness. So we thank you and we glorify your holy and righteous name. Help me to enjoy this moment, but to be intentional so that we'll understand the impact of this historical week. We give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Tap three or four people and ask them, who is it?
Who is it?
Before y'all got to dancing, I had to turn that thing on. I seen a couple of y'all say, oh yeah. Look at your neighbor and say, who is it? This is a very, very interesting week. And if I could be somewhat of a prophet, if I could kind of prophesy a little bit in the beginning, we know that it's first natural, then spiritual. Amen. And for those people who understand this moment, or you just understand the glory of God, can we give God a celebration in advance for the overflow that's about to take place? The more than you have room enough to receive miracle that's about to hit your life. A flood of relief and redemption. Come on, resources, healing, restoration. Somebody shout favor. Favor. Hallelujah. And I dare you, if you came in today, you're a little skeptical, a little pessimistic, unknowing, doubtful, still thinking in a small box, feeling sorry for yourself, suffocating in sadness or melancholy. If you're tinkering on the edge of depression and feeling dead to your situation, you feel wrapped up in circumstances and dilemma, I dare you to shake it off this morning. I dare you to allow the Lord to help you to praise your way up out of it. Amen. If you feel like it, run. If you feel like it, leap. But don't let that thing stay on you. Amen.
Every now and then, you've got to know how to shake a thing off. Look at your neighbor and say, shake that thing off. You got to learn how to shake that thing off, because this is a glorious time. This is the time in the body of Christ where we can begin to shout, because the glory is coming in. We if we haven't understood it any other time during the year, this is that time that it's been celebrated for decades about the glory of God, the centuries of celebration about the glory of God, about it entering into your city. Yeah, I'm prophesying, boy. The glory is getting ready to enter your city. God has not forgotten your city. Amen. And so there's nothing else negative need to be said about the city. Somebody say, the glory is here. The glory is here. And he came in and they said, who is this? Because the Bible says that the glory is about to enter in. As we read the verses in Matthew, we read from the King James and then the Amplified. And so, because my father told me, don't ever read first from the Amplified. So we read it from the King James so that we would have a proper account of what actually took place without all of the exclamation. Then we read it from the Amplified so that we could feel, amen, what the writer was attending to send off as a message to the reader. And so I just believe that the glory is about to enter into our lives. It's about to enter into not only our atmospheres, but our situation. The glory is about to hit. I believe it's what you've been waiting on. I believe it's what you've been listening for and in anticipation of. I believe it's what you heard about. I believe this glory about what they prophesied about. This was the glory that they had been prophesying about for centuries that was going to come in, that Isaiah had prophesied, that Zechariah had prophesied, that they were talking about this particular Messiah. Micah had prophesied, Hosea had prophesied. Everybody had prophesied about a moment, about a time. Everybody had their own angle, their own prop on the tree. Everybody had their own message from God about this time, and it's here. Yeah, everybody said it in a bunch of different ways. We'll slap three people and say, it's here now. It's here now. It's here. It ain't much to say when something shows up. There's a whole lot of ways to say it about how something might be coming, but there's nothing but one way, not but one way to say it's here, and that's saying it's here. And so I believe that what they prophesied for, listen, what others were trying to say, it wasn't going to ever happen. I'm not just talking about Jesus. I'm talking about your life right now. What some people said couldn't ever take place in your life. And sad to say, some people right next to you, you're going to miss it. Yeah, because they just hear. They ain't paying attention. They just kind of wondering what the heck is going on. And then the glory going to pass right by them. And then they're going to be mad at you when you shout. Yeah, but I prophesy, you're about to see it. You're about to see the glory coming in. There's no reason for us to celebrate what happened if it's not getting ready to happen. Yeah, we're repeating the story because the story repeats itself. Jesus in his glory is coming in. And you ought to be able to sense the season. You ought to be able to feel the change. It approaches us quickly. Something happens immediately. I mean, on Wednesday, it was snowing. Yeah, there was hail and freezing rain. And on Sunday morning, we're talking about 75 degrees. It comes quickly. When 1 minute it's dark, and then when Jesus comes, it's light. It comes quickly. 1 minute you're feeling down. The next minute you're shouting. It comes quickly. And all of a sudden, just when you thought nothing was going to happen, here he comes riding in on a donkey. I'm telling you, the glory's about to come in, and it's going to come in, and it's going to surprise you because you weren't looking for it. But you're going to see it, and you're not going to be able to deny it. Somebody shout springtime, springtime. It approaches us quickly, and we've got to understand the times. We've got to be like the sons of Issachar. We got to know the times and understand what the church is supposed to do. That's why sometimes you got to quit being so babyfied where everybody got to prompt you when it's time to praise. Yeah, you better learn how to start saying amen. You better learn how to start praising God when he says something, because God is looking for proper response. He's not looking for you just to be a puppet all your life. He's not looking for you to wait for instruction all your life. Every now and then, your baby ought to leap on the inside of you. Every now and then, you need to hear prophetically. Remember, I told you the apex of the prophetic is not what is said, but it's what's heard. God was looking for some people that know how to hear. That's why in the book of Revelation it said, he that hasn't ear, let them hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Somebody's got to get ready to hear something. Look at your neighbor and say, did you hear that? Did you hear that? God's getting ready to do something. God's getting ready to move, but he never does it before he says it. So you got to get ready for it to happen because he said it before he did it. Look at your neighbor and say, oh God, he's getting ready to do something. He's getting ready to do something. Why? Because I hear it. I hear the abundance of rain. I hear it. Something's getting ready to go on. Did you hear that person at the door? Look at your neighbor and say, did you hear it? Did you hear it? God's getting ready to
do it. There's been a shift. There's something is getting ready to take place. There's an explosion that's about to come. I can't be excited all by myself, because if I was prophesying to myself, I'd be wrong. But there's got to be three or four people out here that's been hearing it, that's been waking up in the middle of the night, that's been hearing something going on. I thought I heard something last night, and then when I went back to sleep, God said, that was me coming in. I'm coming into your atmosphere. I'm breaking into your situation. Every locked door is getting ready to get open. Every open door is getting ready to get encroached. Somebody say, he's coming in. He's coming in. He's coming in. He's coming in. There's a current forecast. There's some situations that the meteorologists try to tell us is going to take place. There's some things that look like they're apparent, but I'm telling you, your present forecast is not your end result. Yeah, God can do what he wants to do when he wants to do it. And it might not feel or look like there's been a change, but I'm telling you, the sun is coming. And God is getting ready to make a move, because it's resurrection season. But you have to understand that as we enter into these dimensions of newness, and we enter in these dimensions of supernatural and breakthroughs and miracles and holy boldness and manifestation and power in all of its dimensions, you have to understand that before he got up, he had to go down. And so that's why the worship becomes so intimate, because of the paradox of our faith. In order for him to rise, he had to go under. In order for him to be alive, he had to die. And so I'm so thankful for the willingness that he had to sacrifice his life for me. See, the reason why some of y'all don't get moved for it, because you think of yourself too much. You think too much of yourself. You think you all that in a back of butter cookies. You think you are a super donut or something. You think you got the Snickers bar with the ice cream in the middle. You think you that. You look in the mirror and you be like, I'm all that. But for real, you ugly than a mug. If you took off of Jesus, if you took off the glory, if you took off the righteousness, if you took off the blood, you'd be ugly than a mug. Slap three people, say, ugly than a mug. You look without Jesus all over you, you'd be tore up from the floor. But because of the goodness of Jesus, I feel like going on. I feel like giving him a shout. I feel like I can make it. I feel like I can win. I feel triumphant. I feel victorious. Somebody shout Jesus. Yeah, that's why it causes you to scream. That's why it causes you to shout, because you understand what you really look like. You can wiggle in here if you want to, but when you go home and take that girdle off, all the truth is revealed. You can come in here and shake it if you want to, but when you're sitting down, you can scratch your skull. God knows what's underneath that. God knows what's under the makeup. All you got to do is be real with yourself, and that'll cause you to love him. That'll cause you to embrace him. That'll cause you to hold on to him, because of the way he makes you look, not because of what you think you are. I'm thankful to God that his love for me confuses my constituents about my testimony. When I begin to say jail and crack and whoredom and all kinds, they get confused because of the title. They get confused because of the articulation. They get confused because of the glory. They get confused because of the anointing. It's the blood that hides all that stuff. It's the blood that don't allow you to see it. Sometimes your testimony is so wretched that if you gave it, people wouldn't believe you, because the blood has turned your life around. The blood has given you a different image. The blood makes you look like what you ever been. The blood gives you a new title. The blood. There's something about the blood. And I love the fact that he got up, but I really love the fact that he shed his blood. He gave God what was intended in order for my life to be reconciled with him. This is my favorite week of the year. This is the year where I halfway lose my mind. The Bible says, and this week salvation came. Yeah, I remember the day I got born again, February the 12th. I remember the day I gave my life to Christ, but it is nothing like understanding the fact that universally this is the week salvation came. He came riding on a donkey. He came low-key. Yeah, slap your neighbor and say, "What? Who I am is low-key right now. It's coming at you low-key. But in a minute, it's going to be HD, baby. You better open your eyes. This going to be a 3D anointing jumping up on you in a minute. I'm coming in low-key, but it's going to be 3D. in a minute. It's a new dimension. It's a season of the supernatural. It's a season of great expectation, because if this week is true, if this week is true, then there is nothing impossible for my life. If the facts about this week, if the texts about this week are authentic, then there is no limit to my life. If God himself manifests in the flesh, rode in on a donkey, and allowed people to arrest him, I didn't say somebody, I said God, in the person of Jesus Christ, allowed this to go down the way the text says that it went down, the way the canon explains it, the way the Textus Receptus recites it, if it's right like this, if this is the actuality of the events of history, this is a bad week right here. This is the week that'll make me shout. This is the week that'll make me give him glory. This separates me from Islam. This separates me from Hebrew Israelites. This separates me from Buddhists. This separates me from Hinduism. This separates me from Judaism. This separates me from any other religion, any other God, any other prophet, any other foolishness. This separates me, and it puts me in right relationship with the creator of the universe. Do you understand who my daddy is? Do you understand who my king is? Do you understand who my worker, my employee is? Do you understand who my friend is? Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. I wish I could sing right there. A good Baptist preacher would have tore it up right there. I'm thankful that God is my friend. I'm thankful that I'm his servant. I'm thankful that he's my husband, man. Yeah, I don't care if you're boy or girl. You ought to look up to heaven and say, hey, boo. Yeah, that's my husband, man. That's the lover of my soul. That's the bishop of my life. That is the king of my entirety. And I love him. This is a peculiar week. It's a week that changes everything. These are the texts that change everything. Matthew 21 changes everything. Read for days, and in one verse, everything changes, biblically and historically. It's a strategic and prophetic week in the history of our faith. Most of the system of our belief is based on the events of this week alone. And it starts with today. Palm Sunday. Let me see your palms. Yeah. It's Palm Sunday. Yeah. It's where we recognize something great has just appeared. Hebrews 11:6 says, "It is impossible to please God apart from faith." In the Message Bible. And why? Because anyone who wants to approach God must believe both that he exists and that he cares enough to respond to those who seek him. Isn't that good news? How many times you done text somebody and they didn't text you back? Don't look at me like you're crazy. I text back as soon as I can. How many times have you called somebody and left a message and there was no response? How many times that you needed somebody in a moment, and by no fault of their own, they couldn't get to you? Or even when they got to you, they couldn't even help you. How many times when you thought the person that you could depend on couldn't help you, wouldn't help you, didn't think it reason to help you? But we've got a Savior that cares enough to respond to those who seek him. And even for those that play the fool and act like they don't need him any other time but their emergency, he'll even respond to them. He'll respond to me after I've acted like we aren't who we are. Yeah, because you know, many of us walk through life and don't want to hold his hand in public. Come on, fellas, we know how to. What, you don't want to hold my hand? You don't want nobody to know you with me? We understand that. And so for many of us, we get through certain sections of our life and we don't want to hold his hand. And then even those of us who do that from time to time, he still responds. See, there's an argument against his existence. There's an argument that he's not real. There's an argument that says that he's a figment of our imagination, that he's cinematic in our mind, but he's not a reality. There's argument that say that it was all metaphorical and that it was a myth, and so it was something to hold on to so that you can feel better and have courage and have confidence. But the truth of the matter is, we got argument against that. Yeah, so theologians say the moral and the biological and the anthropological argument of the existence of God is fulfilled in the person of Christ. And so the fact that I morally can see him, that there is a biology about him, that there's proof in the anthropology of him that he existed, that this is our proof that God is who he says he is. Because the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then verse 14 says, and the Word became flesh, and we beheld his glory as the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Colossians 1:15 says that he's the express image of the invisible God. They began to ask him and say, hey, how do we know the Father? When have we seen him? And Jesus said, how long have I got to be with you that you asking me how to see the Father? He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He is the proof that God exists. And not only is he truth, but he's the final truth. He's the first and the final truth of that God himself does exist. He is the one that gives us the imagery of what this God that we call invisible looks like. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 through 7 says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. It's the miracle working ability of God. It's the infinite omniscient mind of God that brought this thing to fruition, that caused the culmination of him wrapping himself up in sinful flesh and coming down through 40 and two generations, born of a virgin, living a sinless life, 33 and a half years and then a week. Look at your neighbor and say, what a week. Some of us have had some rough weeks. Some of us have gone through some times and didn't think that anything could go right. Murphy's Law was in charge of our existence. What could go wrong did go wrong. It's been a heck of a week. Anybody ever felt like on a Saturday or Sunday that you've had a heck of a week and that you needed a drink? Yeah, come on, put your hand up. You needed something to help you ease your mind. You rolled up a couple of doobies. You had to make sure that you relaxed good. You got Calgon, take me away. You did whatever you had to do. You went on vacation. You went on sabbatical. Let me talk to the spiritual people. You got your Bible out. Feeling bad, you just said, I need a word from the Lord. You began to read and you began to study because it's been a heck of a week. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Ain't none of us all together had a week like this. And for many of us, our week was rough because of us. Some of the people we hate dealing with, if we had put ourselves in a better position, we wouldn't even have had to deal with them. I had a student tell me to pray for him because they can't stand this man at the after-school detention, and they feel like they want to slit his throat, and he's just sick of him. He's always picking on him, always asking him questions, bothering him, making him feel bad, talking down to him. Just went on and on and on. Bishop, I want you to pray about it. I want you to come up here and talk to him. I said, hey, did you say detention? Spell detention for me. You don't have to deal with some stuff if you didn't have detention. You wouldn't have to deal with certain people if you'd have paid attention to stay out of detention. If you would have done what you were supposed to do, certain people wouldn't even be in your life right now. Some of the reason you complaining about people is because you let them people in your door. (Clears throat) I guess that's next week. John 1:1-3 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things, listen, by this Word, all things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. And I've already told you, John 1:14, jump to John 18:3-6, it says, Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. I need you to understand that when you are getting ready to manifest, not only will you have a betrayer, but your betrayer is going to have allies. Yeah, real manifestation comes with betrayal and rejection, but betrayal don't come by itself. It comes with officers. It comes with other men. And it comes with weapons. Some of y'all tripping. In order for you to manifest, somebody close to you has to have weaponry against you. And it's been forming. It's been getting itself together. It's been working its way up. They've been in your cabinet all the time preparing for the betrayal. Yeah, you didn't know that in order for you to become what God wants you to become, there has to be a Ahithophel. There has to be someone who's close to you that gets all your information, that's going to shed it and say it. There has to be someone who will kiss you every day and hold your money, and then when you look up, they had already used your money to pay for your demise. But you can't worry about it, because God designs it that way. Because the truth of the matter is, no matter what your enemy does, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Somebody said, why you don't worry about them and that? You better watch who's around you. Watch your inner circle. No, they better watch out. Because if God is telling the truth about me, you better watch what you put your hands on. You better watch what you put your mouth on. I might not be nothing. I might be the scum of the earth that I've always been. I might not ever amount to anything. But just in case, you better be careful, because if I'm God's anointed, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. Look at your neighbor and say, can't touch this. Yeah, you better be careful. You better be mindful of what you talk about or what you hope goes down. And watch this. And I need a few people. Stop. Somebody say, I need a couple of haters. Because if there's no hater, then God ain't got nothing to prove. I need some people that don't think God's going to use me. I need some people that don't think I'm going to ever get off of drugs. I need some people to think I ain't going to stop jumping from bed to bed. I need some people to think that I'm going to never going to amount to anything. I need some people to think that I'm going to be a drunk for the rest of my life. I need some people to think I'm going to be hooked on these cigarettes forever. I need some people to think that I ain't going to never have nothing but this hoopty. I need some people to think I'm going to live with my mama forever. I need you to think that against me. Why? Because God's getting ready to prove some people wrong. If you know that God's getting ready to do something for you, I dare you to give God some praise in this thing. I dare you to shout, Hosanna! Here he comes to change your life. But you got to be willing to endure the Judases. Better be able to deal with a little trouble. Verse 4 says, Jesus, therefore, watch this. You heard what verse 3 said about Judas. Verse 4 says, Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, watch this, went forth. Hey, Rambo, the Terminator, Action Jackson, Shaft, Columbo, Beretta. Hey, from my old school, Kojak, James Bond. Bond said, Bond, James Bond. The Bible said Jesus was bad. See, for some of y'all to think he was weak, and he was lowly, and he was toe up. Jesus was a man. He was a man's man. And the reason he had to endure temptation is because somebody wanted to be with him. They loved him in the natural. You better understand it. Because he had a heart like David, but he had a body like Saul. He was a carpenter. He had strong hands. He had real biceps. He had to pick up his furniture to deliver it, y'all. He carried the cross, y'all. We're talking about a real man. We're talking about somebody that can carry something that it takes several people to hoist. We're talking about somebody that would use a crane to lift the stuff that he lifted. We're talking about, that's why the Bible says, if I be lifted up. He was a man. And the Bible says he knew Judas was coming with men and officers and torches and spears and weapons. He knew that he was coming. And the Bible says he went forth. He didn't run from Judas. See, the reason why some of y'all not manifesting this is because you're running from your Judas. It's time for you to turn and adjudicate. It's time for you to turn and say, whom seek ye? Who you looking for, Mike Jones? Who you looking for? Who is it that you want? Who is it that you need? Look at your neighbor and say, who you want? Who you want? What you want? That's what Jesus said. Jesus said, what? What? My bishop, a little country, he say, what? What the what? What? And he said unto them, who seek ye? You ain't got to hide in the bushes. Put the light out. Jack, here, what? Who you looking for? Slap three people and say, who you looking for? But this is what I like. He said, and they answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. They made it specific. Because there was a whole lot of Jesuses. It was a whole lot of Yeshuas. It was a whole lot of people from a whole lot of places. They said, I'm looking for Mark McGuire. I'm looking for Jesus of Nazareth. That's me. What? Slap somebody, say, who is it? What? Yeah, that's me. You talking about Jesus of Nazareth? What, that's me? You talking about Mark the dope fiend? You talking about Mark the ex-convict? You talking about Mark the whoremonger? You talking about Mark the manipulator? You talking about Mark the schemer? Yeah, what? Yeah, I understand, because Nazareth not only gave a particular depiction of who he was, but they was trying to tell him where he came from. Yeah, cause can any good thing come out of Nazareth? I need to talk to about five dope fiends that's been delivered. Can any good thing come from a dope fiend? I'm talking about a couple of hoes running around here. Can anything come from an ex-hole? I'm talking about a few pimps that used to run around here. Can any good thing come from an ex-pimp? I'm talking about people full of pride and thought you were religiously correct. Can any good thing come from you full of pride? Can any good thing come from Nazareth? He said, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. And soon then, as he had said unto them, I am he. Watch this. The Bible said, they went backward. The reason your enemy keep coming forward is because you don't know who you are. The minute you begin to declare to your enemy who you is, he'll fall backward. The reason your enemies keep forging forward is because you're confused about you. You don't let somebody else tell you who you are. You don't let the wrong people prophesy over you. You don't let people curse you because of your mistake. I'm telling you, if you don't know who you are, your enemy gonna keep standing tall. David used the stone. Jesus used the word. Somebody say, I am he, I am he. And if the Bible says that they, as soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground there. And you need your enemy on the ground, because you need something to step on. You, I need somebody to put my feet on. I'm sorry for some of y'all that don't like it rough, but in order for me to see what God's got for me on the other side, I need somebody to put my feet on. And when I don't have a friend, God will bring me an enemy, because he made his enemies his footstool. I need to reach something that God's got for me, but in order to reach it, I got to step on an enemy. But in order for my enemy to be on the ground, he's got to fall backward. But in order for him to fall backward, he's got to ask me a question. And after he asks me the question, I've got to know the answer, because my response is going to be the vehicle that gets my footstool in its proper position. Tap three people and say, I need it in position. I need it in position. That's why when you see your enemy, don't you duck. You ought to lick your chops. Oh, shoot, there go a hater. God's getting ready to take me higher. Slap three people and say, I'm looking for it. I'm looking for it. I'm looking for it. I ain't running from some haters. I want a hater. You ain't got to celebrate. If you ain't going to celebrate, go on and hate. That's my new line. If you ain't going to celebrate, go on and hate. Because either way, you're going to help me go higher. Somebody shout higher.
So we've got this week that's moral and biological and anthropological. We've got this week. 1 Timothy 3:16 says, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Somebody say God. So I'm going to help you. See, you got to understand the deity of Jesus. You got to understand that Jesus, he's not just the name of God, he's God. You got to understand it. It's part of our 14 essentials of the faith, that they look separated because Jesus was all God and all man at the same time. And while he was being all God, he was trying to teach us how to be all man. Slap somebody and say, I'm all man. I'm all man. And I know the women, you kind of say, I'm all woe man. You're still all man. You're just woe man. Yeah. But without controversy, you can't dispute this. You can't fight this. You can't make me think nothing different. I don't care what school you went to. I don't care what videos you watch. I don't care what they say on Facebook and YouTube. I don't care what bad theology they bring up. I don't care what proof they try to use. The Bible says that without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Now watch this. The reason it's a mystery is because you don't have faith. Because if you desire for knowledge, if you desire to know truth, then truth will come to you. Credo ut intelligim. It's a Latin phrase that means, I believe, therefore I shall understand. Before you ever get understanding, you got to believe it. I believe that I might understand. And so we also have a historical and bibliological and a Christological argument of the existence of God. And the way it gets solved is through prophecy. Zechariah 9:9 in the Message said, shout and cheer, daughter Zion. Raise the roof. I like that. They was raising the roof back in the day. The roof. The roof is on. Daughter Jerusalem, your king is coming. A good king who makes all things right. A humble king riding a donkey. A mere colt of a donkey. A humble king who makes all things right. Al wasn't just singing about his skin coming back after them grits. He was talking about this good king when he said everything is going to be all right. He's coming back. Like he said he would. And that's what I love about Jesus, because if God said it, if God makes a promise, it's as good as a possession. All you've got to do is get it on the other side of your obedience. Matthew 21:1-9 says, and when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, go into the village over against you, and straightway you shall find an ass tied, a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, you shall say, the Lord have need of them. And straightway he will send them. Look at your neighbor and say, the Lord needs your donkey. The Lord. Yeah, some of y'all thought I was going to cuss. Y'all wanted me to, too. Y'all wanted me to say it. But the Lord needs the donkey. And all this was done, verse 4, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken. Here it is. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell ye, daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek, and sitting upon an ass, a colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they sat him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so God is proving his existence by fulfilling prophecy. And so we go further into our theology, and we understand the ontological, cosmological, and teleological arguments of God. And this existence is validated through phenomenon. This is validated through the things that seemed impossible to bring to pass, the things that seem extraterrestrial. His arrest and his judgment. He suffered the spitting and the ripping off of his beard from his face, the brutal beating with the coat of nine tails full of glass and sharp stones, the beating that Isaiah declared that would be for our iniquity and our transgression, the gruesome and cruel destroying of his flesh with the stripes of a deadly whip. But it's by those stripes we are healed. He was then nailed to his cross, hung, and he had all kinds of possible death, cardiac rupture, heart failure, hypovolemic, hemorrhaging and dehydration, shock, acidosis, asphyxiation, arrhythmia, pulmonary embolism. Death could result from any combination of these factors and other causes, including sepsis, a following infection that's due to the wounds that caused the nails to be scores and to be driven into him that preceded crucifixion, and then eventually he just dried out. One theory holds that when the whole body weight was supported by the stretched arms, the typical cause of death was asphyxiation. The condemned would have severe difficulty inhaling due to hyperexpansion of the chest muscles and lungs. The condemned would therefore have to draw himself up on his arms, leading to exhaustion, and have his feet supported by tying by a wood block. When no longer able to lift himself, the condemned would die within a few minutes. So why Jesus is using all of his energy to stay alive, he still got you on his mind. While he's suffering excruciating pain, while he's bleeding profusely, because remember, it was in the garden that they threw the crown on his head. When they took him from the garden, they put this crown on him in prison, and it was like hypodermic needles that dug down into his skin. Then they beat him. Then they ripped his skin off. Then they made his muscles flinch because of the strain of trying to hold when the whips and the beating came. And then he carried his cross up a hill. Then he hung there for me and you. And he gave some words that were famous that we'll hear Friday. And then his death, his burial, and the phenomenon was the resurrection. His burial, a borrowed tomb that's now empty. His resurrection, the first day of the week, it gave us a new dimension of power and plan and purpose. So this is the beginning of that week. This is the beginning of the time that the glory will come in. And they call it Passion Week, or the Week of Passion, where God ultimately displays his love for all of his created ones, and in an act of redemption and sacrificial atonement for our rebellion and disregard for his strategy and design for our lives. This is that week, Hebdomus Sancta, known as the Holy Week. It's that week. It's that week that includes this triumphant entry, the anointing of him by Mary of Bethany. You know, she just laid down and wanted to anoint him, and they got all upset about the oil. If you don't pour out what you have, you can't get poured on what he has. And so they ate what was known as the Paschal. It was the Passover, his great prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane that we see in John 17:17, his arrest and his judgment, and then the final revelation of himself when he declared, "Ego am I," or in the Greek, it's "I am he." And if you remember back in Exodus 3:14, when Moses asked God, "Who are you?" God said, "Ayah Asha Ayah." And many believe that God was saying, "I was and I shall be." And so here it is, God saying that he is the I am that I am. This week is the foretaste of the life of the ecclesia, the church. This is our life. This is God giving us a pattern. Everything that he does has a pattern, and he's given us a pattern because we're the church. Why? Because we are too, just like Jesus was, the body of the anointed one. Jesus, as the person, was the body of Christ. And so we, as collective church members or church affiliates or Bible believers and disciples, we are the body of Christ. But the Bible tells us if we suffer with him, we shall also reign with him. But we suffer in the flesh and we manifest in the spirit and we reign in this life. That's why you have to have a life of optimism. Faith doesn't see dark days. It sees light opportunities. It sees where the light can shine. It sees where things can change. And so we can't miss it. We got to embrace the moment in our faith. It comes continually, and we allow distractions of life in our mind and our flesh and emotions to cause us to question the very presence of the Holy One of Israel and to disallow us, the church, to walk in the true divine endowment that we've been given. Watch what Jesus said about the body of Christ. Watch what he said about himself. Luke 4:18-21 in the Message says, "God's spirit is on me. He's chosen me to preach the message of good news to the poor, sent me to announce pardon to prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the burdened and the battered free." Watch this announcement the church has to make. To announce, this is God's year to act. You got to receive that. You, Lord, have mercy. How many of you had a heck of a last year? You need God to move this year. Somebody said, "I need him to move." Watch this. He rolled up the scroll and handed it back to the assistant and sat down. Every eye in the place was on him, intent. Then he started in. You've just heard scripture make history. It came true. Watch this. Just now in this place. I'm telling you, scripture just came true just now in this place. Everything that we've read, everything that we said, it came true just now in this place. So this is the time for the triumphant entry, when the glory shows up, when the anointing for change arrives and his majestic impact. Matthew 21:10, watch this. And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, "Who is this? Who is this? Who is it? It's Jesus of Nazareth. Who is it? It's the body of Christ. Who is it? It's the embodiment of the presence and power of God. Who is it? It's the church of the living God. Who is it? It's the Potter's House, Tate International Ministries. Who is it? It's Mark McGuire. Who is it? It's Alonzo Lattimore. Who is it? It's Chelsea Millard. Who is it? It's Veronica Campbell. Who is it? Put your name there. It's John Bailey. Who is it? It's Chris McGuire. Who is it? It's Judy Brown. Who is it? Somebody say it's me. And the Bible calls the church the pillar and ground of truth. And when we show up, and the authority and love that we've been graced with, watch this. The Bible says that when he showed up, the city was moved. When we finally show up, the city's going to be moved. Yeah, look, somebody say, "I'm here now. I'm here now. I was tripping last week, but I'm here now. I'm I'm on my post. Why? Why? Because the city's going to be moved to what? To drug-free neighborhoods. Yeah. The city's going to be moved to a hunger-free zone. The city is going to be moved to schools of academic excellence. The city is going to be moved to a community and people-minded government. The city is going to be moved to a decrease in crime. The city is going to be moved to a reduction in murders. The city is going to be moved to a rise in economic development. The city is going to be moved to have proper housing and employment. The city is going to be moved that it be a downward curve in recidivism and backsliding. The city is going to be moved in millennial empowerment. The city is going to be moved in a paradigm shift of these postmodern thinkers. The city is going to be moved for the arrival and the returning of people coming back to the Almighty God. When the church shows up, the city is going to be moved with compassion and synergy, and there's going to be greater unity and cohesiveness. When the church shows up, the city is going to be moved. Somebody say, move the city, move the city, move. Get out the way. When the church, the body of Christ, really shows up, we're going to see joy on the block rather than rocks and human trafficking. When the church shows up, you're going to have real hope over heroin. There's going to be hope in the atmosphere. Depression and despair and suicide will begin to dissipate. Who is this? It's Jesus. Look what he's going to do. Last scripture, and I'm going home. Starts in Zechariah 9 and 10. I want you to start sitting down. And then when you see you, when it shows you your life, when you get to a point of receiving it, just stand up and start clapping. And I'm going to keep reading. Go on, girl. That's what I like. It's got to be me already. D said it's all me already. Watch Jesus. In the prophecy he's coming to fulfill. I've had it with war. No more chariots in Ephraim. No more war horses in Jerusalem. No more swords and spears, bows and arrows. He will offer peace to the nations. A peaceful rule worldwide from the four winds to the seven seas. And you, somebody say that's me, that's me. Because of my blood covenant with you, I'll release your prisoners from their hopeless cells. Come home, hope-filled prisoners. This very day, I'm declaring a double bonus. Everything you lost, return twice over. Judah, praise is now my weapon. The bow I pull, setting Ephraim as an arrow to the string. I'll wake up your sons, O Zion, to counter your sons, O Greece. From now on, people are my swords. I'm not getting ready to send out swords as weapons. I'm getting ready to send out ex-dope fiends. I'm getting ready to send out ex-hookers. I'm getting ready to send out the people of the mighty God. I'm getting ready to defeat my enemy with people. Then God will come into view. His arrows flashing like lightning. Look at your neighbor and say, you look bright, you look bright. Master God will blast his trumpet and set out in a whirlwind. God of the angel armies will protect them. So, ain't it good news that what God sends us to do, we got angelic armies around us. We got an angelic entourage that protects us. He says, all our war, the war to end all wars, no holds barred. Their God will save the day. He'll rescue them. They'll become like sheep, gentle and soft, or like gemstones in a crowd, catching all the colors of the sun. Then how they will shine, shimmer, glow. The young men robust, the young women lovely. Pray to God for rain. It's time for the spring rain. To God, the rainmaker. Can't nobody make it rain like God. God, somebody say, he gonna make it rain. He gonna make it rain. He gonna make it rain. Spring thunderstorm maker. Maker of grain and barley. Store-bought gods babble gibberish. Religious experts spout rubbish. They pontificate hot air. Their prescriptions are nothing but smoke. I need you to understand everything on Facebook, everything on YouTube, everything on social media that talks about another God, that talks about cursing the church, that talks about our defeat, it's rubbish, it's garbage, it's nothing. It's the pontification of hot air. We win. It ain't nothing but smoke. And so the people wander like lost sheep, poor lost sheep without a shepherd. You can't get to your position in God. You can't get to destiny without the fellowship of the believers. Quit liking mess by people who say you don't need church. Quit liking mess by people that say the church is messed up. People need healing. The church is fine. People need deliverance. The church is fine. Upon this rock I shall build my church. You talking about Jesus got a weak church? Look at your neighbor and say, I might need some help, but the church is good. They tell you the church going to hell, but they in church. They tell you you don't need a church, but they call a pastor when they in trouble. Got your own anointing, but you need somebody else to lay hands. It's hypocritical, and we've fallen for it because they mix it up with nice, smooth words, and you feel bad for their situation because they coming out. Your trauma don't make your foolishness truth. Sympathetic words don't make me gravitate to a lie. I'm furious, verse 3, with these so-called shepherds. They're worse than billy goats. He said, I'll treat them like goats. God of the angel armies will step in and take care of his flock, the people of Judah. He'll revive their spirits, make them proud to be on God's side. God will use them in his work of rebuilding. Use them in the foundations and pillars. Use them as tools and instruments. Use them to oversee his work. Somebody say, he's about to use me. There'll be a workforce to be proud of. Watch this. Working as one. Their heads held high. Striding through the swamps and mud of life, courageous and vigorous because God is with them, undeterred, watch this, by the world's thugs. I'll put muscle in the people of Judah. God, get ready to put muscle in your praise. There's going to be something about your praise going to get your enemy up off you. Look at your neighbor and say, hallelujah. He's getting ready to put muscle in your praise. He said, I'm going to put muscle in the people of Judah. I'll save the people of Joseph. I know their pain, and I'll make them good as new. They'll get a fresh start as if nothing ever happened. Good God Almighty, I don't know about you, but there's a couple of places in my life I need a fresh start. And why? Because I am their very own God. I'll do what needs to be done for them. The people of Ephraim will be famous. Their lives brimming with joy. Their children will get in on it too. That's what I love about God. He ain't forgot my babies. Huh? He ain't forgot my children. He said, oh, let them feel blessed by God. Go turn their hearts that they understand that it's been God, it's going to be God, and it's God right now. It ain't nobody on TV. It ain't nobody on the video. It ain't nobody driving cars that they rented. Man, I was in Miami, boy, and they was riding some cars, boy. Down on Ocean Boulevard, they was riding. And you watch them, man, they riding in these Bentleys, these boys, they was, you know, they worked up. But then they get out the car and can't lock it. If you can't lock it and unlock it, it probably ain't yours. You riding in borrowed stuff. God said, listen, that they're going to feel blessed. They're going to know that they're blessed. Blow the whistle. I'll whistle. And they'll all come running. I've set them free. Oh, how they'll flourish. Even though I scattered them to the far corners of the earth, they'll remember me in faraway places. Let me help some of you. Some of you, the thing that happened to you, the thing that got you separated, the thing that's caused you to feel disconnected. Listen, God allowed that thing to happen because you forgot about him. But watch what he says. But watch what he says. But while you're far away, while you haven't been praying, while you haven't been studying, while you forgot that I existed, I'm going to cause you to remember me while you're still far away. That's going to bring you closer to me. I'll cause them to remember me in faraway places. They'll keep the story alive in their children, and I'll be back. And they will come back. I'll bring them back from the Egyptian west, round them up from the Assyrian east. I'll bring them back to sweet Gilead, back to leafy Lebanon. Every square foot of land will be marked by homecoming. They'll sail through troubled seas, brush aside brash ocean waves. Roaring rivers will turn to a trickle. Gaudy Assyria will be stripped bare, fully Egypt exposed as a fraud. But my people, I'll make them strong, God strong, and they'll live my way. God says so. You ought to give God some praise right there. It'd be a shame for you to be right in the midst of your miracle and miss it. It'd be a shame for you to be right in the midst of this atmosphere and don't sow. It'd be a shame for you not to come to the altar. It'd be a shame for you not to surrender all. It'd be a shame for us to not celebrate this glory. Don't miss this anointing. Don't miss this grace. It's come for your deliverance. God didn't just bring you out of bondage, but he's taking you into your next dimension. God's getting ready to do something extra in your life. God's getting ready to make it happen. God's getting ready to turn your mourning into dancing. God's getting ready to hook you up. Tell somebody, he's about to hook me up. It's 104, so you got to move quickly. God's getting ready to hook you up. Tell somebody, I need it. He says he's going to make his arrow his people. He's going to put muscle in your praise. But there has to be a movement of agreement. There has to be something that you do that's tangible, that says that God is God and that I believe it. So before we give our tithe and offering, I want you to just very quickly, if you need a shift, if you don't move. But if you need a shift, if you need this thing that you just heard me prophesy, this thing I just read, that just now it becomes true in this place for you. You and your family, you want it. You want it. You're getting a fresh start, a Genesis day. And you're going to be willing. You're going to be obedient. You're determined to press like you've never pressed before. It may not be the best you'll ever give him yet, but it's going to be more than you've ever given him before. It's going to be more than you've been giving him recently. It's going to be a determination that you're going to sacrifice something. Your private time, that extra time, whatever it is. Because you need to be in the presence of God. You need to be in the house of God. You need to be connected to the kingdom. You need to be in your kingdom assignment. You need to be on his agenda. If that's you, give me something triumphant. Heaven on earth. Give me something like heaven on earth. I see it. If that's you, I just need you to come slap my hand and then go back to your seat and get your offering ready. We're just connecting. This is your move of faith. We're just connecting. God's going to turn it around, baby. God's getting ready to make a move. We read the scripture. He's going to put muscle in your praise. You just got to shout your way through it. You just got to shout your way out of it. You just got to let God do it and make it happen. God is moving. Come on, nothing magical. It's just a move of faith. It's just a move of faith. It's just a move of faith. God is ready to make it happen for you. God is turning that thing around. 180, about face. God is making some great strides in your life. You'll never be the same. Your life will never be the same. It's going to change. You're going to have haters, but they're going to become your footstool. You're going to have people that celebrate, and then the next day, they're going to turn on you. But that's the betrayal that you're looking for. Good to see you, girl. Manifestation. She told me she was coming, and she came. God's going to move because of your obedience. God's going to make it happen for you. I'm prophesying. It's getting ready to turn. Come on, it's going to be like heaven on earth. Oh, it's going to be some fighting. Oh, it's going to be a little struggle. The enemy's not going to go down without a fight, but it's all right. Hit it again. Hit it again. There we go. He ain't going down without a fight, but I'm already victorious. I win this thing. It belongs to me, because this battle is not mine. It's the Lord's, and God's going to win for me. God's standing up for me. God said he'll be with me. He'll never leave me nor forsake me. He's going to make me his arrow. I'm the arrow in his quiver. I'm going to be the one that God's going to use. You thought he couldn't use me. He's getting ready to use me. It's my season. It might not feel like it. It might not look like it. It might not seem like it. But God's getting ready to use me in a big way. In a big way. In a big way. God's getting ready to turn that thing around. Everything that I had to be comforted in, I'm going to comfort somebody else. Everything that I had to go through, it's because somebody else needs it. Somebody needs me to be the testimony. Somebody needs me to be the hope. Somebody needs me to be real. Somebody needs me to be the proof. Somebody needs me to be the validation. Somebody needs me. Somebody needs me. God's going to use me. Come on. Something's changing. Come on.
See his glory.
See his glory. Come on.
Heaven on earth. Something moving.
Come on. Something's changing. I see his glory. I see his glory.
Feels like heaven on earth. Something moving. Something's changing.
Who is this? The city's about to move. The city's about to move. Come on, somebody shout hallelujah.
Something's changing.
Give a gift out of hand of praise for the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Something's moving, something's changing. How many God strong people do we have in the house? Come on, give God a praise for the word of God this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Something's moving. Something's changing. Feels like heaven. Right here on earth. Glory to God. As you're standing, as you're praising God, as you're giving God praise and honor and glory for the word of God this morning, I'm going to ask you, amen, to follow the instructions of the ushers. It's your time to give unto the Lord, amen, back to what God has given unto you. Allow God to stretch you, amen. Something is moving. Something is changing. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Something's moving. Something's changing. Oh.
Oh, heaven. Heaven on earth.
Somebody also left their keys in the bathroom. I got them right here. Yeah, if you left keys in the bathroom, we've got them right here. Amen. Amen. I don't know if it was a male's or a female's bathroom, but somebody left their keys. Amen. I got them right here if they're yours. Hallelujah. Something's moving. Something's changing. Feels like glory, heaven on earth. We're still praising, we're still worshiping. Hallelujah. God's strong people. Hallelujah. LJ is going to do a panoramic video of us singing happy birthday to our grandfather, Bishop's spiritual father in the Lord, his birthday. We want to celebrate his birthday. We want to shout for glory, and we want to let him know how much we love him, how much we appreciate him, and how he's impacted our life and impacted the life of our father here, the angel of this house, Bishop Mark C. McGuire, Sr. Can you say amen? Come on. We're going to sing happy birthday. Everybody singing, everybody praising the Lord in Jesus' name. According to Minister Pam, going to lead us. Put your hands together for Bishop Paul McLaughlin. Happy birthday! Hallelujah! Give God a shout! Give God a shout for the men of God! Hallelujah! Amen. Glory to God. We love you, Bishop Paul McLaughlin. We thank God for you, sir. Amen. Well, happy birthday to you. We look forward to having you and Lady Darlene here in the coming weeks. Amen. We want to celebrate and have a good time in the Lord in Jesus' name. Can you say amen? Amen. Just for a little while before we leave, amen, we've given. Want to remind you, amen, on each end of the altar are two baskets, amen, and we want to continue to encourage you. You still have time to sow unto Bishop Bob McLaughlin for his birthday. Bishop's going to be going down to celebrate with him. He's going to be taking the seed of God from the house of God. If you have felt it in your heart and you just want to be able to bless him, amen, because of how he's blessed this house and blessed our bishop, please feel free to put something in the altar, in the basket. Also, remember Bishop Mark C. McGuire, amen, our spiritual father, how he pours out. How many of you know he poured out today? Amen. Amen. But guess what? He does this week after week. Day after day, amen, he's pouring out, not only for this house, but for this community and for our city. And we want to show him how much we love him. We want to ask that you would also bless our bishop with a love offering, a seed offering. Just tell him how much you love him, how much you appreciate it. Amen, in Jesus' name. Now, we do know, amen, that in the midst of all the shouting, in the midst of all the praise and worship, in the midst of all of the celebration, amen, getting ready, amen, for our Resurrection Sunday coming up, there's somebody, amen, watching by TV, watching even right here in this congregation, that does not know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Amen. And we celebrate and we love God because we want people to know our story. We want people to know that he lives and that he reigns, amen, even now, glory to God. And that if they would just ask, amen, him to come into their life and to be Lord of their life, amen, that he would step in, glory to God, and take up residence in their hearts and in their home. And perhaps there's one here, amen, this morning. You do not know Christ Jesus. You're amazed at the celebration. You're amazed at the praise and the worship that's been going on in this house. And you felt something, amen. You felt God tugging at your heart. If that's you, my friend, we want to invite you to come to this altar. Symbolizing, amen, that you're giving Bishop your hand, the Potter's House Dayton, your hand, but you're giving your heart over to God. And you are saying, Lord, I surrender. I surrender my life unto you, and I want to be saved. I want to be washed by the blood of the Lamb. I want to be that new creature that everybody's been talking about. The old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. If that's you, my friend, won't you come? This is your time. Everybody's praying. Everybody's believing God for you. We're waiting on you here at this altar. Jesus is waiting on you, and he wants you to know there's still room at the cross. Won't you come? Won't you come? Perhaps you're watching my TV, but while you stream or YouTube, amen, and right there in your home, you want to know Jesus. You too, my friend, can accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. He'll come right into your residence, right there in the midst of your situation, glory to God. He'll take your mess and make it a message. His name is Jesus. Romans 10, verse 9, amen. Come on, praise God for that. His name is Jesus. Come on, hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Come on, somebody say amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Romans 10, verse 9 and 10. Glory to God. Say it in the word of God, my sister. What's your name?
Marnika.
Yeah, Marnika. Blessed woman of God. I'm going to ask my sisters to come and stand with her, one on each side. Amen. Come on. We don't want nobody to know. We want you to know we stand with you. And we're believing from this day forward, amen, that change that they talked about, that being restored, being renewed. Glory to God. That's you. Glory to God. God has changed you inside out right here in this service. Come on, put your hands together for the Lord. The Bible says in Romans 10, verse 9 and 10, that if you confess with your mouth Christ Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, the Bible says you shall be saved. The Bible says, for with the heart man believes unto righteousness, but with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That same salvation that Bishop talked about this morning came riding in on a donkey. The same salvation, amen, that took him to the cross and raised him from the dead on the third day is the same salvation, amen, that has come into your heart. We believe, amen, by your coming forward, by your act of obedience to walk to this altar, you were saved before you even got up here. Glory to God. Y'all better say something. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Amen, 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 amen. Look at the moment she made up a decision, glory to God, to give her heart to Christ, the change already took place. Already took place. You believe Jesus died for your sins?
Yes, sir.
You believe that he was raised from the dead?
Yes, sir.
You believe that if you confess and ask him to come into your life, forgive you of your sins, that he would wash your sins as far as the east is from the west? You believe that?
Yes. Yes.
Father God, we thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For this precious woman of God. And according to your word and by the authority of your word, Lord God, you said if we would confess and believe in our heart,
yes,
that we shall be saved. The blood of the Lamb covers you, washes you clean. In Jesus' name. Can you say it?
Amen.
Put your hands together for our sister and welcome her to the house of God. In Jesus' name. Come on, lift your hands here. Lift your hands here. Turn around. Let them see that beautiful smile. Give God a praise for the woman of God. Hallelujah. 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 Love on her. Love on her. Love on her. Another one snatched from the pit of hell, glory to God, and into the kingdom of God, in Jesus' name. Lord, I get saved. Look at, don't just leave them at the altar. Walk with them, find out their number, get their number, find out where they are, get to know them, amen, so that the devil can't steal them away again, glory to God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I don't know about, I get excited about this. Folks get saved.
Yes, yes, yes,
folks get saved, man. I don't know something about that.
Hallelujah.
And this, my friends, is a trying time for her.
Hallelujah.
See, because the church, we praise God, we love the church. But as a church, we get happy inside the sanctuary. But they walk up out the door, we want them to go check on them. We don't want to see who, we don't want nobody even ask where they are. Come on, get to know the people of God. Our color is love, is that right?
Yeah.
Our color is love.
Yes.
We're going to follow that sister and that brother and all the others that have come to this altar and give their heart to the Lord. We want to make sure we keep in touch with them. Glory to God. Those are our brothers and our sisters in Christ Jesus. Perhaps there's one here this morning. And I didn't get to ask that sister, but y'all make sure y'all ask that sister upstairs, glory to God, if she has a church home. But perhaps you don't have a church home, or you wanna make the Potter's House Dayton International Ministries your church home. You believe that the Lord is telling you this is where you're supposed to abide. This is where you're supposed to be taught and be learned in the Word of God. Bishop is an awesome teacher. I said he's an awesome teacher. The anointing of God is on his life. Hallelujah. And so we invite you, amen, if that's you, you want to make the Potter's House Dayton International Ministry your church home, we invite you to come to this altar. Amen. We want to receive you as our brother and sister in Christ Jesus, and we want to welcome you home. There's no place like home. I don't care what folks say. I don't care what folks do. Let me tell you something. I don't care what folk on the street is talking about at the Potter's House. My friends, there is no place like home. This is our home. This is our family, and we thank God for each and every one of you in this household of God, in Jesus' name. Put your your hands together one more time and give God a hearty praise for his love, his mercy, his grace, and the truth of his word, and for our family in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, glory to God. Amen. Folks, we got saved. Okay, I got the keys again. Somebody got the key? If it's a car out there, it might be a Cadillac out there. So you better come and get these keys. Amen. Because Brother Miles would think it's a gift. Amen. 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 Lexus, might be a Lexus out there. Mercedes Benz or something. Amen. You better come and get these keys. Hallelujah. I've been praying for one. Amen.
You
got one of our special keys on it, too. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Baby, you get the car, I'll meet y'all at the house.
I hear you.
Amen. Hey, we love you. We thank God for you. We thank God for the word of God. We look forward to next Friday, Good Friday. We're going to invite you to come out on Wednesday night. Come out again on Friday night. We're going to have a wonderful time this week praising and celebrating Passion Week and getting ready for Resurrection Sunday. You don't want to miss what God has in store for your life this week. Amen. Look here. Go in peace. Allow the love of God to rest, rule, and abide in your hearts. Take time to forgive. Look here. We're getting too old. Hallelujah.
I hear you.
We're getting too old to keep holding on to things. Look here, life is too short. God is coming in, and we want to be ready when he comes. All minds clear? Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Lord, we honor you. We glorify you. We adore you, Lord God. We give you all the praise, all the honor, all the glory for what our hearts have felt, what our ears have heard, and what our eyes have seen in the realm of our Heavenly Father. Now may the God of peace, that brought again from the dead our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, may he make you perfect unto every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his